So how might we use measures of inflation? One question we might have is whether a $10,000 salary way back in 1950 is more or less than a $60,000 salary in the year 2000. So pulling from our data, the CPI in 1950 was approximately 25. The salary in 2000 was approximately, the CPI in 2000 was approximately 175. Remember that the base years was the 1982 to 1984 period. If we want to convert across time, what we can do is apply the formula shown in the slide. We look at the current equivalent, the year we want to convert to, compared to the past value times the ratio of the old CPI and the new CPI. So the formula is as follows. If we want to look at the value of what something in 1950 would be equivalent to in 2000, then we apply the formula. So here, $10,000 is the value back in 1950. We want to convert this to $2,000. So the current CPI, the year 2000 CPI, is 175. The past CPI is 25. So essentially, the CPI is seven times as large as it used to be. Applying the formula then, $10,000, the past value, times the ratio of the new CPI to the old, 175 over 25, or 7, and multiply those two things together, and we come up with $10,000 in 1950 is worth $70,000 in 2000. In other words, $10,000 in 1950 is worth more than $60,000 in 2000. Our next task is to convert back and forth between real and nominal measures. And what we're going to look at right now are some historical data on gross domestic product. In the first case, what we're going to do is look at nominal GDP per capita, the average income per person, and convert that from a nominal measure into a real measure. What I've done is taken from Fred Stats from the Bureau of Labor Statistics some important data that will allow us to do this. If we look at these three columns here in our table, we have the 1960, 1970, 1980, 90, 2000, and 2010 GDP deflator. This is what we're going to use for our index. And we also have nominal GDP per capita. Right? So this is the actual amount of dollars people used. It says here that people earned on average $3,000 in 1960, but that's not a very meaningful number. What we want to do is to convert that into something that corresponds with what we would think of as today's dollars. So to do this, the first formula, which is just essentially a rewrite of the one that was on the previous slide with slightly different language in its place, to convert from nominal, which we have, to real, which is what we would like to use for a comparison basis, we apply the following formula. So to put this in 2010 dollars, which is the most recent year we have in our data, and the most recent year I have the GDP deflator index, what we want to do is apply the formula here, the formula in cell B8. So our real value here, we want this cell to equal the nominal value, which is given in this case, cell C28, times, in parentheses, the ratio of the new GDP deflator divided by the old GDP deflator. And this tells us that, let me bring the size of the cells up, this tells us that $3,006 in nominal terms in 1960 is actually corresponding with $17,000 in average income in 2010 dollars. So when we convert the past nominal measure into a current measure, we can see what we can come up with a number that's a little bit better, a little bit easier to use for comparison. Now note that what I can do is just copy these cells down. I'm going to lock our reference cell in B78 and copy this formula down to the other cells in the column, and we can see what a real measure of each of these nominal values is in current dollars. So $3,000 1960 dollars, it corresponds with $17,000 in today's terms. $5,246 in 1970 corresponds with $23,000 and so on down the line. And in 2010, the indexes, the nominal and real values match because this is the year we're converting our dollars to. Okay, the second one, I want to show you a small adjustment if I want to go from real to nominal. And essentially what we want to do is take the GDP deflator and use the past measure and current measure. So essentially what we're doing is we're flipping the formula to get us to go back the other direction, right? So in this case, if we want to go from nominal to real, we essentially want to solve this equation for real, and what we're going to come back with is the inverse of the index. So let's do this here. To convert real GDP, this is real GDP in 1960. In other words, this is a measure that's already been converted, and I pulled this from Fred Stats. What we want to do is essentially the reverse. We want to take the nominal is equal to this, is equal to the real measure times, parentheses, the past value of the deflator, 1960 value, right, divided by the current value of the deflator, 101.2. And let me change the font size here again. Crunch down my decimal points, and we can see that this is in billions. So $3 trillion is a good current estimate of what the size of the economy was in 1960. But $3 trillion was actually, in nominal terms, just $500 billion at the time. Again, I'm going to lock the reference cell. Copy this formula down, and we can see in nominal terms what GDP looked like. Interestingly, 20 years ago, GDP in nominal terms was only $6 trillion. It's up over $16 trillion now. But in 2010, we were looking at $14.8 trillion for nominal GDP, and correspondingly, the 2010 measure matches since this is the year we're converting everything into. The final item to discuss is the distinction between real versus nominal interest rates. The nominal interest rate is the stated interest rate on an investment, or the change in value from the beginning of the year to the end of the year in percentage terms. So, for instance, if I invest my money in a certificate of deposit, I might get a 1% annual interest rate. Or if I invest in a corporate bond, I might get a 5% interest rate. Or I might observe a 7% return on my stock investments or something like that. But to really understand the real return that I make, I have to account for the fact that prices are rising at the same time I'm earning interest. The real value of interest depends on how much more I get in purchasing power, not just how many more dollars I have at the end of the year. So, for example, if I buy a $100 bond that pays me a 5% interest rate, at the end of the year I have $105. If the inflation rate was 3% that year, that is, if prices have gone up by 3%, then that's not like having $105, it's like having just $102. The bundle that used to cost me $100 now costs $103. So I haven't made the full 5% on my money in real terms. To get from the nominal rate of inflation to the real rate, I'm sorry, the nominal rate of interest to the real rate, I have to subtract off inflation. So in the example shown, if my nominal rate of interest is 5%, the inflation rate is 3%, my real rate of interest for the year was 2% on my investment.